Well, obviously, I was aware of Dylan Thomas, and I did a production of Under Milkwood many years ago at the National Theatre, which was fantastic, amazing experience with a Welsh cast, the first ever Welsh cast to have been assembled by the National Theatre, first Welsh production ever put on by the National Theatre, which was kind of a bit late in the day, in my opinion, but there we are. So it was a work that, so Under Milkwood was, a work I was very, very familiar with, and very, very fond of. And then Kevin and I have been trying to work together, since Twin Town, really, and never quite found the project. And, having thought about it, this seemed kind of perfect, really. Luckily, through a series of, events, it was funded and came about, and here we are tonight, very pleased with the finished product. The piece is innately, I believe, cinematic, it's full of extraordinary kind of flowing and imagery that's in constant flux, which lends itself to cinema, although it's described as a radio play. I think it was described as a radio play because that would have been the kind of most accessible medium at the time it was written. I'm sure if Dylan was writing now, he would certainly be writing or be very, very interested in the cinema. So I think it was kind of a natural evolution for this piece to bring it to the big screen. And of course, what the screen does is it, because of sound in the cinema, the developments in sound since the play was written have been immense, more so almost than the moving picture. So in the cinema with this piece now, what you get is an all-enveloping experience, visually and sonically, and hopefully physically as well as a result,
The film has such a sensuous, kind of lustful quality. Can you talk about that aspect particularly of the production?
Again, that's innate in the writing. It's there, it's a pagan fest, as I describe it earlier, and Dylan again was, of course, interested in this. That's a theme that runs through a lot of his writing, horned ones and hoovered ones, and so we haven't added any erotica or sensuality to it. It's there, it's part of the writing, and we've just cranked that up a little bit because I think that's what the piece is about. There's something really celebratory about these lustful Welsh men and women. I think that's another a great asset to this piece, is the women in it are as horny as the men,
Obviously working with people like Charlotte Church, what was that experience like?
Fantastic. Unfortunately, I didn't have as many scenes as I'd have liked to have done, but people are describing her as a singer, but she's an actor now as well. She did amazingly, and she looks just incredible and sounds, as we all know, beautiful. So, I'm really, really glad she's in it.
Well, I suppose in terms of what the film Under Milkwood is such an incredible play. Dylan Thomas's writing is so unusual. And I'm quite a newbie to acting. I've done bits and bobs in the past. And just the whole idea of working with this incredible ensemble cast, the challenge of having to do it in Welsh as well as English. I'm not a Welsh speaker. A myriad of reasons that got me first interested. Okay, so Under Milkwood is set in this fictional Welsh town called Llareggub. It's pretty much like a dreamscape, surreal. It's a real sort of voyeuristic look at the inhabitants and their innermost personal lives and deepest, darkest secrets and desires. And my character is Polly Garter, and Polly Garter is pretty promiscuous. She's not liked by a lot of the villagers. The men are all right with her, but a lot of the women sort of don't think kindly on her behaviour. But it's a bit more complicated than that, because she's actually all she seems to want to do is procreate. So it's not really about the sex or sort of ego boosting or anything like that. It's about having babies. It's about procreating. So she's sort of this Mother Earth figure as well. But also throughout it, she's constantly pining for her lost love, the one she really did love, who's now dead. And so she's constantly singing and pining for him. But also she's quite an isolated character because lots of people in the village don't approve of her actions. So she seems to be quite alone. Not that she seems to care about that. She's also like a seriously strong woman, and whatever anybody else is saying, whether she knows or not what they're saying behind her back, she doesn't seem to care anyway and carries on with whatever sort of behaviour she wants to. I think it was really interesting the way that both the male and the females in Endermilkwood in general, but particularly in this retelling of it, are equally sexual beings. So they sort of both have this really feral, animalistic want and desire, and it's, you know, generally it's more sort of shown that that's how men are and women aren't, you know, quite the same. So I thought that was refreshing to show both genders as being really kinky and sex crazed. I took away so much. I met some incredible friends. And I never really expected to. I didn't know what I expected. I suppose I just didn't really have a clue what to expect, since I'm, you know, not often on film sets. But I met some incredible people. I truly thought the musicians were the most hedonistic out of the creative folk. But how wrong I was! I realised that actors are far more hedonistic. But I've made some like real friends for life on this production. And I think Kevin Allen and lots of the other crew and people that worked on this film have got a really special way of bringing people together, a really brilliant idea of how people will work together. And I think he and other people were masterful in sort of picking the cast.
I'm curious, is acting something that you've always been looking to do?
No, not necessarily. Generally, I've had a pretty mad career thus far. And I just tend to follow my nose. If something interests me and somebody's asking me to do something, I'll have a look, see if I fancy it, see if I think I can add anything to it. If I don't think I can add anything to it, or maybe it's too complex a role for me, or you know, then I'd be like, ooh, I don't know, I'm a bit scared. But no, there's no burning desire that I've always wanted to be an actor. But yeah, I've had a ball.
And what's next for you?
I have no idea. I don't know. I have to ask Kev.
Hi, my name's Murray Lachlan Young, and I am the co-adapter of Endermilkwood.
Can you talk about the, I guess, challenges you faced in adapting such an iconic work for screen?
Yeah, there were plenty. I think one of them is because it's such an incredibly well-loved text. Everybody has an idea of what they would like from it. There's also a 1972 movie which is existing or is in existence, and we had to try and make a departure from that. We also had to get into the mind of Dylan Thomas and try and do. And I suppose our big thing was that we decided that we were not going to run from the darkness or the sexuality. Well, I think the idea of the kind of lustful elements of the film is that they're all there in the text. And I think a lot of previous adaptations, visual adaptations of it, have kind of decided to just sweep them under carpet slightly. And we decided not to do that, and to also try and add some humour to it when we could. Been a real kind of, I guess it's been something we've spoken about a lot, and I think that if you take the power of his incredible, I suppose number one is his amazing lyricism, his fantastic lyrical poetry, his adoration of nature, his almost spiritual take on nature, and his wordplay. Those are the things I think that set him up as a great poet. And then you have his kind of alcoholic, slightly angsty, almost angry views on people, and how he can seem to love people and hate them at the same time. I think that's an interesting balance. I think what we have decided Endermilkwood is about for this movie, and some people may agree and some people might not, is that it is a journey into the dreams of a sleeping Welsh village post-war, late 40s, early 50s. And it's a celebration of the mad, in, not mad, I would say, but the it was based on an original text called The Town That Was Mad. But it's this idea of individuality within culture and a celebration of that before things like mass consumerism overran and have overrun the world. And so this is a last glimpse in a very surreal, dreamlike way into the way that things were, visualized by Dylan Thomas and many of the other thinkers of the time.
Well, I decided to do it because I was relocating from Ireland back to my hometown of Swansea, having farmed, given up filmmaking for about 8 years. I wanted to do something big and juicy and Welsh, sort of and iconic. It was the centenary, the Dylan Thomas centenary coming up. Just felt the right thing to do. Do you want me to hold that? No, okay. Just felt the right thing to do at the right time. Be careful what you wish for, though. It's a very diverse, eclectic, big cast. I mean, they had to be first language Welsh, bar Charlotte and maybe one or two others, to cope with the back-to-back process of shooting it in Welsh and English. So, in a way, you sort of, you know, you feel a bit shackled, but it was the opposite for this, for me, because it just made the process so natural and quick, and it devoid of that jigsaw casting procrastinated nightmare that it can be sometimes, you know. There's a lot of good actors in Wales. I was happy hiring some, you know, sort of non-actors, inexperienced actors, I felt, that were right for this. And, yeah. The period setting was, yeah, I mean, we didn't make it spot on 1951 or whatever. It was just sort of 50s-ish, because it's a dreamscape. We felt we'd add license to kind of not be too tight on that. It felt, because it's written at a time and it's of a time, and the text, the poetic prose is of a time. We did think about maybe upgrading it to, you know, the 70s and contemporary, and it felt wrong. It just felt right to let it sit in that time. The erotica that kind of runs through the piece is there in the writing. It's not something I cottoned onto too much when I did it for O-level. It was on the curriculum when I was a kid. But yeah, I felt that having kind of attacked it again and looked at other productions, you know, over the years, it's never really alluded to the erotica that's just really in there. I mean, and not to have it, I think, would be doing the piece a disservice. And so I felt it was important to bring that out into the cinema.
How important was it having someone like Rhys Ifans involved?
Well, very important to have a marquee, you know, film name in your movie. I mean, independent films is, you know, it's tough enough to shift a movie. Rhys and I had worked together on Twin Town. We've always stayed in touch. We've always been mates. We've speculated other projects. It just felt the obvious thing to do. I mean, and I, you know, he jumped at it because it's an actor's magnet, you know, a Welsh actor's magnet anyway. And I think he's done a great job in terms of bringing the piece out of its RSC-ness, that I felt it was, you know, the previous, I mean, a fantastic rendition of Burton is of, again, it's of a time and it's of a generation and it's of a style. And although, you know, Burton was obviously Welsh, there's a kind of anglicised presence that I just wanted to bring it, Rhys to bring it back home to Wales. It's a Welsh piece of work.
What are you hoping that audiences, both those familiar and uninitiated in Dylan Thomas, take away from the film overall?
Well, I think, you know, Thomas has been kind of swept under the carpet for quite a long time. He's the most translated English language poet in the world, which is incredible, bar T.S. Eliot. He's an important poet. He's of a beat generation. He was a multifaceted writer. He was already speculating, working with the likes of Bunuel, musicians like Stravinsky. He would have ventured into all these other mediums. He was an animal for new stuff. And unfortunately, you know, he died young. But In terms of audiences, we've spent quite a long time this summer taking the film around arts festivals, counterculture, audiences, Latitude, Festival Number 6, Green Man, etc. So we found it was quite interesting to get a reaction from a different audience, like not just a one-dimensional film art house audience. We really feel this is sort of, in a way, more than a movie. And it's, Rhys describes it as sort of, what did he say? It's like watching an album. Is how he put it, and he's got a point, because it's an unusual experience, and so we're finding that we're connecting with a new audience now who actually don't necessarily know Under Milk Wood, don't know Dun and Thomas, and hopefully keeping the existing Dun and Thomas audience happy.